Hey crew, I've got the key to this 22 Lexus LX 600. We are going to take it for a drive on and a bit of off-road, but first let's check out how it looks on the inside and outside. All new for 22, this was an opportunity for Lexus to give it a bigger grill. And boy did they. It actually doesn't bother me, but if it does bother you, you can get it blacked out so it blends in better. There are standard LED headlights and LED daytime running lights. You've got these blacked out corner vents, and this paint color is called Manganese Luster. What a name. It's like a grayish brown. In profile, this range topping ultra luxury trim gets the biggest 22 inch wheels. They're a silvery chrome. The design goes with the exterior of the vehicle. Not my favorite look though. They're wrapped in Dunlop Grand Trek all terrain tires, 265 section front and rear. You've got some chrome bits on the body color matching door mirrors, chrome on the window trim, and satin silver roof rails, chrome on the door handles, and oh my gosh, we still have the fixed sidestep. Talk about looking dated and something that's going to get hung up on the trails. Why do we still have that, Lexus? I would rip that off almost immediately. Looking at the profile, why does it still look so much like the Lexus LX of the last generation? Because it still has the same 112-inch wheelbase that the LX has had since 1995. And this one, with the active ride height, is sitting in the low setting of the air suspension, so it sits 2 inches lower than normal, but it can race up 7 inches above the normal ride height for off-roading. At the back, we've got a roof-mounted spoiler, LED taillights going across the whole tailgate, which is now a single piece. They got rid of the split tailgate. Bums me out so much. That was so practical, so useful, and it's gone on both this and the 300 series Land Cruiser. There's a gray painted lower bumper. This cap right here comes off to access the hitch. And the towing rating is now up to 8,000 pounds. Back looks too much like the Toyota Sienna or the Land Rover Discovery for me. But apart from that and the sidestep, I like the exterior of the new LX 600. Let's check out that interior. Opening up and looking inside, the range topping trim is a 4-seater, whereas all other LX trims have a third row with a total of 7 seats. You can also only choose this black semi-annealing leather, which feels really good. This cool stitch pattern on it. These back seats are heated, ventilated, and massaging. On the doors, we've got black open pore wood trim. You can kind of see some of the ambient lighting. There isn't much of it in this cabin. I'll show you a clip from it at night. You've got manual sunshades. I think these should be power. A lot of gloss black here and power one touch windows. Nicely padded leather armrest and a Mark Levinson reference 25 speaker 2400 watt sound system with clear notes and tons of bass. To get up and in, of course, you have your fixed step and a grab handle. Sitting behind my own seating position at 6 feet tall, I've got enough knee room, but I really think there should be more. And the foot pockets are kind of tight, so I can't slide my feet very far under. Thigh support is great though, and so is headroom. With the 4-seater, you get this fixed console area. Lots of gloss black to collect dust. Two cup holders there. And then we have some USB ports in here and more storage back behind there. There's also a wireless smartphone charging pad, this quilted center armrest, well padded, and deep console storage with more USB ports and a DC outlet. You also get this fixed tablet with every setting for your climate control, for your audio systems. Yes, you have two 11.6-inch touchscreen infotainments, and they're super responsive. They have the same software as the infotainment up front, and you can also do things like move the seats and even set your massage preferences. Back to the seats, if you just hit this one button here, it will send that seat sliding forward and this one angling back up to 48 degrees. And that's enough with the footrest coming out for me to stretch out at 6 feet tall and not have a bend in the knee. It's really very nice. Let's check out the front. Such a well-built noise. Up front are heated and ventilated leather chairs, power adjustable. You get your Lexus illuminated tread plate and Lexus monogram on the headrests. More of that black open pore wood trim and ambient lighting, 3-position memory seats, a setting to control the right seat, 4 one-touch windows, power folding door mirrors. There's a power tilt and telescoping wheel. Press and hold that button there to release the tailgate, which is not in a hurry. You have 44 cubic feet of space behind the second row, which you cannot power fold forward or even manually fold forward like you can the third row. You have an AC outlet, jack under the floor, and a spare tire underneath. Power close and lock features on the tailgate as well. There's a grab handle to make it easy to get up and in. You have a beautiful wood and leather rim steering wheel. It's heated, 8-inch gauge cluster there, it's reconfigurable, head-up display, got some paddles on the wheel which feel great, settings for your adaptive cruise control and lane keep assist system, 12-inch digital gauge cluster that's quick to respond, has a high refresh rate, it has wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Below that is a 7-inch display, very different graphics than this one, interesting, with your off-road settings or your climate control, chunky drive mode selector off to the left, and 2-speed transfer case off to the right. 2 USB ports, 1A1C. This is not a wireless charging pad, and neither is this one, interestingly. More drive selections here on and off-road, baked on a wood panel, not gloss black. Thank you, Lexus. 2 cup holders, quilted console cover, under which you find a cool box. You can also open it on the right side. There's a digital rearview mirror to cut through the clutter in the cabin, and a sunroof. Not a panoramic glass roof this day and age. Visibility out the back is excellent without the third row. The cabin is super cozy and the tech upgrades are appreciated. Just as not a chauffeur, I don't think I'd spend the extra money on the four-seater. Let's take it for a drive. All right, let's fire it up. Get that cool graphical demonstration every time you hit the start-stop button, and the twin-turbo V6 sort of purrs relative to the rumble of the V8 from the predecessor. We're going to be starting off in what drive mode? What do we do? Let's say normal. Just going to start it off in normal, and then we'll pull back on the gear selector to go into reverse. That prompts your duo of camera angles. You've got the bird's eye view, and then you've got a wide-angle backup camera, both in high resolution. And if I go into drive and hit the view button off to the left-hand side, there's your wide, super wide front camera view. Gets even better too, because there are more camera options to choose from off-road in low range. And watch, when I turn the wheel, the vehicle goes transparent. So you get a better perspective seeing through the body of where the wheels of the vehicle are. And there are your trajectory lines, of course. Is not the direction I want to go. I want to go in this direction. Because we've got to do a turning radius test. Let's see how tight the LX600 turns. Okay, so from straight, fully cranked. Wow. That is quite tidy. A concise turning radius. And the horn? What's that sound like? Here we go. Sounds like a very refined horn, actually. Loud enough, I'm certain, outside, but this is a well-insulated cabin. The initial bumps we've gone over have felt like nothing. Thank the hydraulic fluid pressure suspension. It's not an air suspension per se. It's using hydraulic fluid at all four corners. You can see we didn't spring for the navigation on this one. Did we, Lexus? It's okay. Talking about the powertrain, no longer do we have the V8. Instead, we now have a twin turbo V6. It displaces 3.4-ish liters. It's like 3.45. And it makes 409 horsepower and 479 pound-feet of torque. Those are bumps. 26 more horsepower and 76 more pound-feet than the outgoing V8. And it actually sounds pretty good. Like, it's very quiet when you're just at partial throttle, but when you dig into that throttle, it's a melodious note. And it's
plenty of grunt. More power, complemented by the fact that Lexus shaved off 441 pounds from the predecessor, mostly due to strategic use of aluminum, including on the hood and fenders and on the roof. Less weight, more power, more performance. And that engine is mated to a 10-speed automatic gearbox. Lexus built it internally. And it's smooth in the way it works through the gears. I mentioned that suspension is really good at low speed bumps, but I will say, as the speeds do build, you get some more of that characteristic body-on-frame shiver that makes the vehicle feel more unsettled. It's still definitely among the most well-riding ladder-frame SUVs I've ever driven. And the largely great ride quality is complemented by superbly comfortable seats. I mean, I just squish into them, and yet they don't fall apart. They hold me in place. They're just like, these are mileage warriors. I would spend a lot of time in these, a lot of distance, and feel fresh at the conclusion of the drive. We do need to find out how quick the LX gets to 60, so I'm going to go into Sport Plus mode and pin the throttle with the race box going. Seconds? I mean, it totally felt it. That was actually properly quick. 6.5 seconds, though. That kind of crushes Lexus's estimate of 6.9 seconds. Now for a mid-range test. The hustling continues, though this 10-speed automatic does not appear to be in any sort of hurry to downshift. Yeah, that takes a while to get you in the right gear. And I mean, yeah, it's not a performance vehicle, but Sport Plus, come on. I pin the throttle. It's like, right, you wanted speed. Okay, downshift. How about manual mode? Let's try that. Okay, about a full second or more before you can downshift after pulling the paddle. I mean, it does get moving. The gear shifts just are not, they're not quick. Custom drive mode, where I've set it up to be the softest ride quality, but good throttle response. And at these speeds, it's tremendously hushed in this cabin. For something as big and blocky, ooh, let's do the brake test, from 60, so much nose dive. I thought the back was gonna somersault itself forward. The brakes definitely worked. The initial bite was, actually, I wasn't even sure I had started pressing the brake pedal, even though I knew I pinned it. I was like, are we actually going to start braking? But then they do clamp down, and indeed, they do stop in sufficient time. They'll work in an emergency situation, but I really thought we were just going to go butt over face. But how does it handle, right? Dive in, power on. Oh, it's sloppy. That was a sloppy Joe. Tons of body roll. I mean, I shouldn't be surprised after the braking test and the nosedive, but yeah, it really has some sway in corners. And Lexus does say it actually lowered the ride height, so there's actually less ground clearance as standard in the LX, but that was to give it better handling properties, and it feels about the same as the predecessor in terms of just wallowing in corners. Now at these highway speeds, I'm going to engage the adaptive cruise control system, set my following distance, and we've got the lane trace assist here working for us. See how well it's going to hold in the center of the lane on this curve. Perfectly. Wants me to grab onto the wheel. And then it goes back to its merry business of really just relaxing you. This is the road trip stuff right here. And as I was saying, the cabin is hushed, not getting much wind noise. There's, you know, a faint brush of it. Road noise, very minimal. It's piping on 22-inch wheels. Yes, indeed. This is still a cruiser of the land that's not called a Land Cruiser here in the U.S. But it's underpinned by the same TNGA platform under which the 300 series Land Cruiser sold abroad also rides. Does it uphold the Land Cruiser / LX name off-road? We need to find that out. And before I forget, if you guys want to hear the sound system, this Mark Levinson reference sound system, you're going to want to watch my night drive where I give you a good demonstration of that. On to the off-roading. Well, today's off-roading portion is going to look quite different than I had anticipated. I went to my favorite off-road site, talked to a firefighter, learned that there's an active fire going on right now. So actually all of the off-road sites in the area are closed down. This is very much plan B or C or D. However, we are going to go up and down this steepish hill. And for that, we're going to go into neutral. I'm going to berth this over to the low range set of gears. And that brings up different camera angles, including shots at the wheels. And then from here, I'll go into multi-terrain select, which you can in fact now for the new generation LX, go into multi-terrain select while still in the high range set of gears. And then we'll hang out in auto mode. Now, by going into the low range set, that was going to raise the air suspension up to the highest high two setting. And that process does take a while, but doesn't mean we can't get moving. I have no doubt that this is not going to pose a challenge to the LX, but I'll be honest, this is probably as intense as an LX buyer who, especially one who chooses the 22-inch wheel option, is going to be looking at. It's like, get me off the pavement, take me to a good campsite. This is really as hard as it's going to get. And this is just cake for this truck. Furthermore, the dimensions of the LX, though it's smaller than some of its rivals like the Escalade and Grand Wagoneer, really pay benefits here on tighter trails. You're not so much worried about scraping on branches or not being able to make a maneuver. And otherwise, hard impacts like that with the hydraulic fluid suspension feel like nothing. The Dunlops can dig in and just gracefully work our way up this hill. Purposefully I'll dip into craggier bit. And metered throttle input just means you're going to scamper up everything up to, Lexus says, a 45-degree incline. And that's our hill. That's it, folks. I promised it was going to be brief. And when you go out of multi-terrain select into DAC/crawl, that gives you the option for the turn assist. And this is going to drag the inner wheel and allow us to cut a turning circle by a couple feet. Which works beautifully. I mean, no way without that would I have been able to turn around right there. It sounds like you're killing the truck, but it works just fine. And while we remain in crawl control, I can now use the drive mode selector to set the speed at which we descend. Taking my foot off the brake and gas, I can now just focus on steering and choose the right line to take down the hill. It makes this just so painless. Now, this is the top speed for descent. So you might get bored of this and end up taking over the braking for yourself. And that's going to do it for the off-road portion. I told you it would be brief. I do want to show you one other camera angle I didn't on the trail. And this one shows you the back end of the truck kind of looking through, which really helps when you're cresting over hills, getting to see through the obstacles. And I am now going to take us back into high range. And then I'm going to drop down the air suspension, fluid hydraulic suspension, whatever, to the normal ride height, which is way quicker of a process than raising it up. And we're going to head on out of here. The takeaway for me, though it was short, from our off-roading is that the LX 600 is every bit as effortless in the weight off-roads as the predecessor, and importantly, as it is just enjoyable and effortless to drive on-road. And that's what this truck is supposed to be. It's supposed to be just something you don't have to think about. You just enjoy it. You encounter dirt trails, you encounter a tight serpentining uphill, couple quick settings, and you're good to go. And furthermore, I didn't show it, but you also have a center locking differential. So if it gets really challenging, you have more tricks up the LX 600 sleeve. Now let's talk about how it stacks up against its other luxury full-size rivals. So the starting figure for the new LX 600 is just over $88,000. This one, as tested, is a whopping $127,000. This is the range topper. You don't need this unless you're a chauffeur. Get the luxury trim, spend $104,000, get back to third row seats, and have all of the niceties, including that sound system and the semi-aniline leather. It's a really nice package. The fuel economy for the Lexus LX 600, I did not mention, has definitely been improved over the outgoing, 14 combined. It is now 17 city, 22 highway, and 19 combined. And that's a real asset when you're comparing it to its competitors. That's how that works, compared to competitors. One vehicle you might consider, the Cadillac Escalade. That one starts at a reasonable $77,000. But if you want the bells and whistles, the one I tested was well over $100,000. So it's really a competitor to the luxury trim of the LX 600. That one makes more power, 420 horsepower. It gets to 60, well, on paper, quicker at 6.8 seconds. But as we found out, 6.5 for the LX 600 is quite quick. And the fuel economy is worse at 16 combined. Cargo space, well, that's a lot better. It's over 100 cubic feet when you fold down all the seats. Then there is the Land Rover Range Rover. And I have not driven the new generation. I look forward to that. But that one starts at $95,000. It makes 395 horsepower. It gets to 60 in 5.9 seconds. Fuel economy is even better than this at 20 combined. And cargo capacity is actually a little less than the LX 600. And then there is the Jeep Grand Wagoneer. That one starts at just under $90,000. It makes a whopping 471 horsepower and gets to 60 the quickest at 5.4 seconds. Fuel economy is the worst at 15 combined, and cargo space is right up there with the Escalade. I think it's even a little bit better. Where the LX 600 absolutely shines is, as I said, in the way that it just puts you at ease, whatever the road conditions. Whatever the trip you want to take, you're going to know the LX 600 will get you to your destination. This interior is very comfortable. The technology upgrades are nice. They're not cutting edge by any stretch of the imagination. I think that the Range Rover looks a lot better. The Escalade definitely looks better. The Grand Wagoneer and this are about the same in my interpretation in terms of exterior aesthetics. Interior, some competitors do have nicer interiors. This has everything you need. Why I might choose the LX 600 over the rivals is if I think I want to hold on to this truck for a long time. I'll tell you what, in 4, 5, 8 years, which one do I think I'm going to be able to just hit the start stop button, fire up, and then go do anything with the truck? It's going to be the LX600. Even though we're losing out on a V8, we have this new twin turbo V6, you know that Toyota Lexus have built in reliability into this truck. It's going to keep, for lack of a better word, trucking. So that's the LX600. I hope you guys enjoyed this PV drive review. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel. Hit that bell to get notified. I knew this wouldn't be quick. And I'll see you next time.